Now, some COVID-19 referral hospitals report a spike in the number of admissions following Metro Manila's shift to general community quarantine last June 1st. The Philippine General Hospital says it now admits 172 COVID-19 cases daily from just 70 to 80 patients per day. The Lung Center of the Philippines also saw an increase in the number of patients from the first week of June. Meanwhile, San Lazaro Hospital says the number of people requesting for swab tests has gone up. Now, for more on this, we have Dr. Tony Lechon. He's the Special Advisor to the National Task Force Against COVID-19. Good morning, Dr. Lechon, and thank you very much for joining us this morning, sir.
Thank you very much, Christian, and to the televiewers. Good morning. Maganda umaga po.
Okay. Now, of course, you know that the President last night made that decision to extend the GCQ here in Metro Manila. Now, as far as Cebu City is concerned, it will be placed under a stricter lockdown measure. Now, we know that there are a lot of questions regarding the data coming from the DOH still, despite 3 months of dealing with this coronavirus pandemic. Now, is this a good move based on the data, which are still raising a lot of questions at this point?
Well, what we do at the National Task Force is to look at the other data analytics experts. And aside from looking at the delayed data coming from the Department of Health and try to maximize its use, I personally consulted a lot of people who are experts in the field. One particular expert is Dr. Benjamin Ko of the UST Hospital and an epidemiologist. The other one is data analytics expert Edson Guido of ABS-CBN. And then the UP pandemic team of Dr. Ted Erbosa and some other researchers. So, and then look at the European CDC data as well as the Johns Hopkins. And from there, we can create some analysis on what to do regarding this case, given that the DOH data might be delayed and not be granular, as we have lobbied for a long time that it should be actually be corrected, enhanced, and improved.
Okay, wait, Dr. Lechon. So are you saying here that as far as the National Task Force is concerned, your basis was not just the DOH data, but also those other data that you mentioned? But again, this other data were based on the information coming from the DOH.
Correct, but they have a different way of explaining that. Because as you can notice, with all transparency, and of course we are all Filipinos, at the IATF and the National Task Force, your role is actually to create and of course come up with data that would be beneficial and of course helpful to the President and the IATF. So we need a lot of references aside from the Department of Health data.
But does it
I'm trying to say is that we need to consolidate all of the inputs coming from different epidemiologists and experts and data analytics, and of course use the Department of Health data.
But
sometimes when you look at the data coming from the Department of Health, you might actually notice that there might not be enough explanation for the numbers, let's say, for the fresh and late cases, for the deaths. For the deaths, it has come to our attention that it has been delayed for about a month or two. So the 22 deaths last Saturday was a shocker, considering that was about and of course the number of cases on that day, considering that you have only 2 days for the President and the ITF to decide on this. And then of course last Sunday or yesterday they had a 1 o'clock presser, and as well as an apology issued by the Department of Health in terms of the mistakes or errors in their daily reporting. And that's a good sign that they are recognizing these particular mistakes or errors in their daily reporting.
But you, as a special advisor to the National Task Force, do you still trust data coming from the DOH?
I trust them, but I verify. I learned that particular mantra from after working with our boss, Secretary Galvez, and the other military generals and cabinet secretaries, like Secretary Anyo and Secretary Lorenzana. The mantra is to trust the DOH data, but verify as well using other references.
Okay, but now if that is the mantra that you're talking about, that might also not inspire a lot of confidence to a lot of people, considering that the DOH is supposed to be the lead agency in that interagency task force, yet even you yourself has been raising questions about those data. I refer to your tweet a few days ago. It didn't exactly look cryptic. In fact, I think you were saying a lot of things in that particular tweet. You said the lead agency has lost focus on everything: risk communication, priorities, data management, and execution of all plans. What exactly were you trying to say here?
Well, Christian, it's a tough and question. But aside from a national task advisor and health reform advocate, and for the longest time, I'm an independent health reform advocate. And as a team member, you sometimes ask accountability with all your team members. Aside from an NTF advisor, I'm also a father. I'm also a son. I'm a Filipino citizen. That our lives, the unemployment rate, the poverty, have three kids. Their dreams and careers will be shattered if we will not be able to come up with data that will be important in decision making. So last April 20, when I was at the palace, there were three important things that I told the president. It was a short message, but the most important is actually, I told the president that we need real-time and granular data. It has been 2.5 months, Christian, and we're trying to come up with, you know, all of these measures. I would say right now the Department of Health has stepped up because of their partnership right now with the UP pandemic team, and of course inviting other guests in their 4 p.m. presser, particularly Dr. Benjamin Ko, Dr. Anna Lim Ong, and other experts who would actually explain the data churned out by the Department of Health. And I think this is a positive move. And also issuing apology on the delay of the reports. These are important things. And I think with self-introspection, you'll be able to help out by admitting or, you know, accepting some of your limitations and mistakes and weaknesses.
Okay, we understand that. And we also laud the men and women at the DOH for the hard work that they have been doing for the past 2.5 to 3 months. But you can't help people from raising questions regarding how the leadership has been going about this going about handling this particular health crisis. For example, it's been almost 3 months or 3 months, and yet we're still talking about certain murky parts of the data collection and data interpretation coming from the lead agency itself. What does it tell you?
Well, that's the reason behind that particular. There is an episodic, emotional, silent outburst on a part of an NTF advisor. It's something that you want to express without, of course, assaulting the health agency. I know there are unrecognized, faceless men and women who are working day and night. But sometimes, looking at the big picture, there are also other lives lost. More than 1,000 lives lost. There are many healthcare workers who have perished. There are many people who are jobless, 17.5% unemployment rate. And all of these things can be solved if you could come up with timely, real-time, and credible, and trustworthy, and granular data. Because all of the decisions and policies of the IATF and even the president are anchored on real-time and granular data.
Okay, now,
and that's what I'm trying to say, Christian.
Okay, we know that there are also gaps committed by DOH Secretary Francisco Duque, at least as far as his critics were concerned. In fact, many of them earlier called for his resignation. Now, given how you see things from where you're sitting at the National Task Force Against COVID-19, do you think the DOH Secretary has to go?
Well, time and again, I know you will ask that question again. And perhaps it's not good, of course, to comment on the leadership style of other cabinet members or perhaps Secretary Duque. And 1 month ago, I was also asked by Ms. Karen Davila regarding this. And I told Karen specifically that the president still trusts the Secretary of Health. And number two, according to I think Ulysses Grant, that you cannot change horses in midstream, and I still believe that, given that you have about 1.5 to 2 years to go and the learning curve will be very difficult. But I'd like to advise, of course, the health agency leader to perhaps reflect, rest and recharge in the way that and he was asked also that particular question in one particular press con, and his answer was he works at the pleasure of the president. But I would say I would also reflect that he should also work at the pleasure of the people. I think he needs to step up. He needs also to hear the voices of the people and perhaps reflect on some other plans or measure, and perhaps a very brief 3-day team building with the direct reports and come up with a business plan for the next 3 months, given that you have a new epicenter right now. The epicenter before was National Capital Region. Now you have two epicenters. And we cannot fight too many battles considering we have finite resources and manpower. So I was just asking whether the secretary would be able to, knowing that you have a new undersecretary, that's Yusek Leopoldo Vega, and perhaps this is a best time to regroup, pull back, and then revisit some of your programs and see how you can work it out in order to improve and control the epidemic. I think he needs also a guiding coalition of members from the academe or a private sector, because the job of the secretary right now is really tough, and perhaps develop a new vision and a strategy in the next 3 months. Then communicate this strategy or vision. I think he needs to inspire a lot of people by empowering broad-based action and generate short-term wins and show to the public what you're doing, perhaps a checklist or a dashboard, and then try to consolidate the gains and produce more change together with the other cabinet officials and the private sector.
Okay.
And perhaps by doing this, the people will understand that the health secretary is doing his best, and then try to anchor all of these gains into a new culture and try to institutionalize it. This is just a positive feedback that I hope the secretary can actually reflect. I have nothing against the secretary. My full respect is always for the secretary, and I always wish him well,
okay,
that he will be healthy, and of course, emotionally, physically, and mentally.
Okay, and of course, to be fair to the Secretary of Health, this is not an easy job. This is the first time that we're having to deal with a pandemic of this scale. And assuming that, for example, another person, for example, like you, is placed there, you would also be expecting a lot of criticism, because that's par for the course.
This is not an easy job. I do not envy the position of the health secretary. I'm just an ordinary citizen and an advisor, but I care for the health secretary, being a Tomasian, and I worked with him in the field health. I know his job is, you know, Herculean at the time, and you need a lot of effort. So we need to inspire also the secretary, and we need to understand, especially that the president trusts him. But I would actually suggest to regroup and then talk to the direct reports, and then invite a lot of private sector experts in order to help him in the next 3 months.
Okay, Dr. Tony Liatjon, thank you very much for joining us this morning, sir.
Thank you very much, Christian.